Have you ever felt that you were living in the Matrix? Have you ever felt like you awoke to a dark truth of what reality really is, of how things really are? And do the people around you sometimes seem like they are ostriches with their heads buried in the sand? Well, with the complete inundation of government lies and corporate media propaganda, it's easy to understand why most people live in blissful ignorance. So this all reminds me of my favorite story, something that I learned studying philosophy that completely rings parallel to today's world. Plato's fictional dialogue, The Allegory of the Cave, and it goes like this. Imagine a dark cave where prisoners have lived their entire existence, facing nothing but a blank wall. The prisoners are chained to be completely immobile. Behind the prisoners is a walkway that separates them from a giant burning fire. The fire casts shadows onto the wall of objects and people that pass through the walkway. Now, the prisoners cannot see the walkway or the people carrying these objects. All they can see are the shadows. These shadows that they see are all that make up the prisoners' reality. All of their culture and knowledge is entirely based on what the shadows do. In the same way that we preoccupy our lives with mindless entertainment, waiting for hours in traffic, sitting in a cubicle, staring at a computer screen, doing something we loathe, and stuffing our faces with garbage, and we do all of this believing that there's no alternative, that life is nothing more than that. Well, one day, someone from the real world, one of the people who normally cast these shadows onto the wall, decides to enter the cave and free a prisoner. He unshackles him and tells him to come outside of the cave. When the prisoner complies, he's at first blinded by the sun and then horrified by the realization that his entire reality is nothing more than an illusion. So Plato then poses a question that is a personal challenge innate within us all. When after getting a glimpse of an ugly truth and scary reality, would you choose to go back to blissful ignorance? Would you be scared of the personal responsibility that will inevitably come with the truth? Or would you pursue it, no matter how horrifying it may be? Realities such as accepting the fact that this government kills its own people. It sacrifices us to advance an agenda of global control, military dominance, corporate profit. Those are the realities that so many people choose to be blinded from. Dark truths like Operation Northwoods, a government plan drafted to stage an attack and kill Americans to preempt a Cuban invasion in the 60s, JFK assassination, 9/11, or the fact that what the government tells us is safe to eat is really killing us. Or how about the fact that the corporatocracy rapes and pillages the earth simply for profit, without a care for the fate of humanity or this precious environment? And that the establishment pushes religion and political dogma onto us to stifle a collective consciousness from growing, one that may phase them out. But ultimately, finding the truth is up to you. It's a decision you have to make, and nothing else will ever be more important than this decision. So, do you shackle down your mind and subscribe to old school paradigms? Or do you liberate yourself by acknowledging reality? Sure, the world would lose its innocence, but wouldn't you rather know the truth?
Want to know what it is. The Matrix is everywhere. It is all around us. Even now, in this very room.
You can see it when you look out your window or when you turn on your television. You can feel it when you go to work,
when you go to church, when you pay your taxes. It is the world that has been pulled over your eyes to blind you from the truth.
What truth?
That you are a slave, Neo. Like everyone else, you were born into bondage, born into a prison that you cannot smell or taste or touch. A prison for your mind. Unfortunately, no one can be told what the Matrix is. You have to see it for yourself. This is your last chance. After this, there is no turning back. You take the blue pill, the story ends. You wake up in your bed and believe whatever you want to believe.
You take the red pill. You stay in Wonderland. And I show you how deep the rabbit hole goes. Remember, all I'm offering is the truth, nothing more.
A seed today, a seed that will inspire you to move forward in life with enthusiastic hearts and a clear sense of wholeness. The question is, will that seed have a chance to take root, or will I be sued by Monsanto and forced to use their seed? Which may not be totally Ayurvedic. Excuse me if I seem a little bit low energy tonight, today, whatever this is. I slept with my head to the north last night.
Oh man. You know how that is, right, kids?
Yeah. Woke up right in the middle of Pitta, couldn't get back to sleep till Vata rolled around. Crazy. But I didn't freak out, you know. I used that time to eat a large meal. Connect with someone special on Tinder. Because life doesn't happen to you, it happens for you. How do I know this? I don't, but I'm making sound, and that's the important thing. That's what I'm here to do. Sometimes I think that's the only thing that's important, really, you know? It's just letting each other know we're here. Yeah. Reminding each other that we're part of a larger self. I used to think Jim Carrey is all that I was. Just a flickering light, a dancing shadow. The great nothing masquerading as something you can name. Seeking shelter in caves and foxholes dug out hastily. An archer searching for his target in the mirror. Wounded only by my own arrows. Begging to be enslaved. Pleading for my chains. Blinded by longing and tripping over paradise. You didn't think I could be serious, did you? I don't think you understand who you're dealing with. I have no limits. I cannot be contained because I'm the container. You can't contain the container, man. You can't contain the container.
Thank you, sir.
If I may ask one last question. You had to know this union scheme was doomed to fail.
Yes.
Then why did you agree to it?
This is what General Apis asked of me.
What, to be executed?
If I had remained invisible, the truth would stay hidden. I couldn't allow that.
And what if no one believes this truth?
Someone already does.
Good God. I've just been recounting your astonishing adventure. Please join us. Get him a chair.
No, thank you. I cannot stay.
Oh, what are you doing here? I thought the doctor said at least 3 weeks in bed.
He did, but this couldn't wait. I need to speak with you, sir. Privately.
Of course. Excuse me. Is that the contract from Reverend Horrocks?
It is indeed.
Well, you know, I could have sent a boy. Are you insane?
I owe my life to a self-freed slave. And I cannot, in good conscience, participate in this kind of business any longer.
This would make such a good book.
I'll drink to that.
Outside, fat snowflakes are falling on slate roofs and granite walls. Like Solzhenitsyn laboring in Vermont, I shall beaver away in exile. Unlike Solzhenitsyn, I shan't be alone.
East to work with the abolitionists.
What? That poison has rotted your brain?
Oh, if it has, I highly recommend it. I've not felt this good in years.
Zelda, I forbid you from going anywhere with this madman.
I've been afraid of you my whole life, Father. I'm going with my husband.
Adam.
Listen to me. For the sake of my grandson, if not your own, there is a natural order to this world, and those who try to upend it do not fare well. This movement will never survive. If you join them, you and your entire family will be shunned. At best, you'll exist as pariah, to be spat on and beaten. At worst, lynched or crucified.
Everyone looks at you as the greatest stand-up comedian.
That is not true, but I appreciate it.
I think a lot of people do. Do you consider yourself the greatest
stand-up? No. Dave Chappelle still lives and breathes.
Okay.
And, you know, the fact that the industry blacklisted him for the last 7 years does not take away from the fact that he still walks the earth. So I stand in deference to him, but I am the king of all of the rest of comedy. Let's make no mistake.
So you're definitely number two.
No, we don't do numbers.
You're the king of the rest.
At least the underground.
Okay. Okay.
Some of us are against the Illuminati, and we are against the Illuminati at our own detriment. Mm. When people are against the Illuminati, then they get punched in the face all the time. The press hates them, and nobody likes them. End quote.
I mean, we all love Dave Chappelle.
Exactly. Dave Chappelle has never been a part of the Illuminati. They don't want him or me or people like us.
Yeah.
But now it's not necessary for us to stir up that hornet's nest unless we intend to get stung a million times. I didn't understand that. They had to sting me a million times.
Right.
I'm still not going to join, but I respect it a little more.
All right. How do you handle that? Because they put your name in the press with a lot of rumors and a lot of situations that they try to put on mm-hmm. Cat Williams. Do you feel ever the need to, like, I gotta go defend this and put out a story about who I am? Or do you just let that kind of like roll off your back when
As you can see, I've let it all go for quite some time. And a lot of that is just based upon the fact that I don't really know how to complain because all of the people that I ever looked up to had to go through it too. So I know how much they talked about Martin Luther King, and I know what they end up doing to him. I know this same story about Jesus and a few of my uncles. So now I know that if your mouth is really, really big and you try to tell the truth for a living and you like to air people out, hatred is coming your way. I didn't know it was going to be this type of hatred. Mm-hmm. But, you know, I'm concrete in all things because of He who strengthens me. So that doesn't mean I always make the right decisions, but I am going to stand by what I stand for. And I'm only continuing to do it because I was looking for somebody who was doing it instead of me. And I just must have missed them, you know what I mean? So at some point, you have to figure out what example are you trying to be. If it's just going to be you going to make it and live happily ever after and go off into the sunset, then that's what that is. Otherwise, you're on the front line of this battle. And those of us who understand that, understand that this is a part of what comes with it.
Okay. This is intriguing. I believe the word is evil, people. Evil! This will come in real handy when they redecorate hell. Can't you just feel the darkness, the dark forces working within it? It's enough to make a nun go bald. This piece represents man's eternal quest to destroy the Alaskan king crab in his natural habitat. Either that or it's just a big ugly eye and I hate it.
You're dead to my painting!
I'm giving it a sty.
Stop it, you idiot! Stop it! It took me 4 hours to create the great piece of art and you've ruined it!
I've seen better art in the bathroom at Sizzler, honey.
Come on, moron!
I swear I could just park my nails in your face right now.
Go ahead and try it. I dare you.
Most of us who have lived with the events of 9/11 have, as a result, experienced some kind of trauma. It can be very difficult to come to terms with what actually happened at the World Trade Center. In fact, someone told me recently, "I wouldn't believe what you're telling me even if it were true." Our petition signers, with psychological expertise, have stepped forward to offer their insight. While this segment is clearly outside the knowledge base of the architects and engineers for 9/11 Truth, these experts in psychology highlight their valuable experience for us as to why this evidence can still be so difficult for people to accept.
At this point, we have 9 years of hard scientific evidence that disproves the government theory about what happened on September 11th, and yet people continue to be either oblivious to the fact that this information exists or completely resistant to looking at this information. So the question becomes why? Why is it that people have so much trouble hearing this information? From my work, I think we would be remiss not to look at the impact of trauma. My name is Marty Hopper, and I'm a PhD clinical psychologist. I've been working and living for the past 30 years here in Boulder, Colorado. For the past 11 years, my work has focused on helping people who have experienced personal trauma. Now, as we know, the horrors of what happened on 9/11 were televised all over the world, and they were televised, in fact, live. We witnessed the deaths of almost 3,000 of our fellow Americans. We know this had a very severe and traumatic impact on a majority of the population. I myself cried for weeks after September 11th. A friend of mine who is a psychologist in practice here in Boulder said that her caseload increased tremendously after 9/11, and people that she hadn't seen in 10 years were coming back into her practice. So I think it's safe to say that collectively as a nation, because of what happened on September 11th, we experienced trauma.
I'm Fran Schur, and I have a master's degree from the University of Colorado. I've had a private practice as a psychotherapist and as a licensed professional counselor for about 20 years. Why do people resist this information, the information that shows that the official story about 9/11 cannot be true? What I've learned is that as humans, each of us have a worldview, and that worldview is usually formed in great part by the culture we grow up in. When we hear information that contradicts our worldview, social psychologists call the resulting insecurity cognitive dissonance. For example, with 9/11, we have one cognition, which is what our official story of 9/11, what our government told us, what our media repeated to us over and over, that 19 Muslims attacked us. On the other hand, we have what scientists, researchers, architects, engineers are now beginning to tell us, which is that there is evidence that shows that the official story cannot be true. So now we've lost our sense of security. We are starting to feel vulnerable. Now we're confused.
9/11 truth challenges some of our most fundamental beliefs about our government and about our country. When your beliefs are challenged or when two beliefs are inconsistent, cognitive dissonance is created. 9/11 truth challenges the beliefs that our country protects us and keeps us safe and that America is the good guy. My name is Bob Hopper, and I have a PhD in clinical psychology from the University of Cincinnati. For the past 29 years, I've been a licensed PhD clinical psychologist in Boulder, Colorado. When your beliefs are challenged, fear and anxiety are created. In response to that, our psychological defenses kick in, and they protect us from these emotions. Denial, which is probably the most primitive psychological defense, is the one most likely to kick in when our beliefs are challenged.
I'm Danielle Dupre, PhD, originally from Switzerland, where I studied psychology and psychoanalysis. For the past 15 years, I've been empowering people who have experienced significant trauma. America is a powerful nation. It has never been attacked. We were confident, we felt secure, and all of a sudden that security collapsed. People started to be fearful. With all those rumors, those news, people didn't know what to think about. And it's a very, very uncomfortable state to be in. And eventually, our mind shuts off. Just like when a computer is overloaded, our minds get overloaded. We can't handle it anymore, and we shut down. It's easier to deny it and move on with our lives.
What some of us will tend to do is deny the evidence that's coming our way and stick to the original story, the official story, and to try to regain our equilibrium in that way. Another thing we can do is decide to look at the conflicting evidence and be sincere and be open-minded and look at both sides of the issue and then make up our own mind about what reality is.
I'm Dorothy Lorig. I have a master's degree in counseling psychology from the University of Colorado, and I've been practicing reevaluation counseling for over 16 years. If we can think of our worldview as being sort of our mental and emotional home, I think all of us will do just about anything to defend our homes, to defend our families. And so I see that with people, and I saw that with myself when my brother tried to talk with me about it, of don't mess with me, don't mess with my home, don't mess with my comfort with how things are. And about a week later, I read a lengthy article by Professor Griffin about why he believes the official account of 9/11 cannot be true. And it was a very well-researched article. I was in my office at the time. I sat there and I felt my stomach churning. I thought maybe I was going to be sick. And I leaped out of my chair and ran out the door and took a long walk around the block, around several blocks, and just broke down. I understand now that what was happening was my worldview about my government being in some way my protector, almost like a parent, had been dashed, and it was like being cast out into the wilderness I think is the closest way to describe that feeling. And I sobbed and I sobbed, felt like the ground had completely disappeared beneath my feet. And I knew at some point during the walk that I knew that I was going to have to become active in educating other people about this, that there was, that for me to retain any sense of integrity, I was going to have to take some action. I couldn't just let something like this go.
Many people respond to these truths in a very deep way. Some have a visceral reaction like they've been punched in the stomach. To begin to accept the possibility that the government was involved is like opening Pandora's box. If you open the lid and peek in a little bit, it's going to challenge some of your fundamental beliefs about the world.
Well, here are a few of those spontaneous initial reactions to hearing the contradictory evidence about 9/11.
I don't want to know the truth, or I'd become too negative and psychologically go downhill. I'm not sure I want to know. If this is true, then up would be down and down would be up. My life would never be the same.
Fran, I refuse to believe that many Americans could be that treasonous. Someone would have talked. But these are beliefs. They are not scientific facts. But these beliefs do keep us from looking at the empirical evidence.
I'm David Ray Griffin. I taught philosophy of religion and theology at the Claremont School of Theology and Claremont Graduate University. I published about 35 books in my field. But then, starting in 2004, I started publishing about 9/11. And since that time, I have published 10 books about 9/11. You have empirical people who will simply say, look at the evidence, and if it's convincing, I will change my mind. Other people are paradigmatic people. They have a paradigm. They say, this is the way the world works, and I'm convinced this is the right way the world works. 9/11 doesn't fit into that paradigm, so I don't need to look at the evidence. It's paradigmatic. And then there is a third type of person that we often call wishful thinkers. I call it wishful and fearful thinking. So they simply will not believe something that they fear to be the truth. And I found that maybe to be the most powerful factor of people rejecting 9/11 truth and not even entertaining the evidence.
So whenever we say, I refuse to believe, we can be sure that the evidence that's coming our way is not bearable and that it's conflicting with our worldview much too much.
Denial protects people from this kind of anxiety.
As I thought about all of these responses, I realized that what is common to every one of them is the emotion of fear. People are afraid of being ostracized, they're afraid of being alienated, they're afraid of being shunned, they're afraid of their lives being inconvenienced, they'd have to change their lives, they're afraid of being confused, they're afraid of psychological deterioration, they're afraid of feeling helpless and vulnerable, and they're afraid that they won't be able to handle the feelings that are coming up. None of us want to feel helpless and vulnerable. So we want to defend ourselves. And the way we often do that is with anger. So then we become angry. And when we become angry, then we become indignant. We become offended. We want to ridicule the messenger. We want to pathologize the messenger. And we want to censor the messenger.
So how can we overcome this resistance and denial? The first thing is to meet people where they're at.
One thing is that we need to raise people's awareness about this through what I would call gentle dialogue and gentle questioning. My name is John Freedom. I'm a counselor in private practice here in Tucson, Arizona, which I've been for the past 20 years. I hold a master's level certification in NLP, which is neuro-linguistic programming. So it doesn't work to challenge people's belief or immediately tell them, you know, I know the truth about 9/11, but a good way is to Ask questions, ask open-ended questions, and lead them into a dialogue and discussion about it.
Healing comes through facing the truth, experiencing it, allowing the feelings to come in, so that if there are feelings of fear that perhaps these events were caused by something that we haven't thought about yet, dark elements within our society, for example, we'll let that come in and explore it. Let the light shine on whatever happened. This will be the most healing process. The Germans did this after their war. The South Africans did this after apartheid. Reconciliation through the truth is what is a deep path to psychological recovery from the myths and lies around which this historic event has been cloaked in the official view. I am Professor William Woodward. I'm trained in the history of science with a PhD. I also have a master's in experimental psychology. I've edited 4 books and published well over 20 peer-reviewed papers. I've taught for 35 years at a state university, the University of New Hampshire. I think as a psychologist, to overcome our fear of the traumatic event with new information would be the best, healthiest route to our collective recovery from the trauma of 9/11. That, by the way, is a psychotherapeutic insight that to gradually uncover the truth in your own life, the sources of anxiety, to make them conscious, is the royal road to recovery.
One of the ways to deal with the trauma is to find the answers. That's why I think it is of such importance to have a comprehensive investigation.
To work together to expose what happened, regardless of where the evidence takes us. That's what we expect in our state government, law enforcement. I think that by putting science together with the law, we will have a psychological healing around the impossible cognition that has been produced on that day.
I believe that to be the kind of country that we think we are, we have to face some of the things that are not as we think they are.
I'm Robert Griffin. I am a licensed psychologist practicing in Pennsylvania for 25 years. I am a member of Psychologists for Social Responsibility, and I am past president of the Northeastern Pennsylvania Psychological Association. After World War II, part of the way that Jewish people honored the dead was by making sure that the truth was known and that the value of these people was respected. Not pursuing the truth about 9/11 disrespects the value of the life of the people that died. Thinking that we're above such things, that it could happen in other countries, but it couldn't happen here, that's a lack of humility, and that's excessive pride. And so not being able to see our dark side or our weaknesses is the most dangerous thing.
The observation that pride is one of the basic human flaws is absolutely correct. This is especially true for Americans, because we for a long time looked at other nations and say, oh, they're in such bad shape, but luckily we don't have those problems. We don't have leaders who would do those things that were done in the Soviet Union, or done in Germany, or done in Japan, and on down the list. So this is a type of pride that Americans have. A feature of American history that makes us particularly liable to this pride is this notion that's called exceptionalism, that America is the exceptional nation. And that began from the beginning, as this country was formed. The people would say, well, there was so much evil in the European country. So much cheating, so much lying, so much using the people for the ruler's purposes, but not in America. We have leaders that are free from those sins. So I think this has made 9/11 particularly difficult for Americans.
Anyone can make mistakes, but our ideals and our principles get us back, you know, on track.
This is one of the defining issues of our time.
So we need to understand that questioning is patriotic. Questioning is what we're supposed to do as citizens. That's our duty.
When we come to the national level, when something like 9/11 happens, we need to be sure that we have a real investigation into who the perpetrators are, and then we need to be sure that those perpetrators are held legally accountable. It's part of the healing process on the individual level as on the collective level. We need the truth in order to heal.